If you had a chance to meet one of the late great rock stars of yesteryear, who would you choose? Would you get John Denver's John Hancock, take selfies with Elvis, drink Hendrix gin with Jimi Hendrix? If you're one of the two protagonists from Stephen King's short story, You Know They Got a Hell of a Band, you don't have to choose. But that's probably not good news for you because you're in a Stephen King story.
You don't want no part of this.
The Stephen Kingdom Jukebox lets us examine Stephen King and his work through a more musical lens. Music, especially classic rock, features prominently in a vast majority of King's work. King's musical references can range from a simple name drop of a song title to a more deeply woven thematic relationship between story and song/artist. In this episode, we'll explore the relevance of rock, the gloom of glory, and Stephen King's particular proclivity for presenting pop music in his prose through the lens of one short story that's essentially nothing but that. So, grab your favorite chocolate malted and boogie on down with me to the Stephen Kingdom Jukebox presents, You Know They Got a Hell of a Band. You Know They Got a Hell of a Band was first published in the 1992 anthology Shock Rock and appeared the following year in Stephen King's short story collection Nightmares and Dreamscapes. The story's title is a reference to the song Rock and Roll Heaven, a tribute to the great rock stars of the past, and the best known version of which is a 1974 cover by the Righteous Brothers. If there's a rock and roll heaven, will you know that? The linchpin of this little horror story is the rural Oregon town that serves as its setting, the appropriately named Rock and Roll Heaven. But is this really heaven? Or is it hell?
Hell!
The premise of this short story is pretty simple. The two main characters, Mary and her husband Clark, become hopelessly lost on the rural roads of southwestern Oregon thanks to a series of stunningly bad navigational decisions by Clark. Just as he's about to admit defeat and turn around, however, they come across a sign for Rock and Roll Heaven, Oregon, a little town that's so picture-perfect it makes Mary's skin crawl. Clark makes yet another stunningly bad decision when he stops the car in the middle of this unsettling town at the Rock-a-Boogie Diner to get some sodas and pie. It's here at the Rock-a-Boogie Diner that we discover the meaning behind King's evocative story title. When the Righteous Brothers crooned about rock and roll heaven, they were presenting a love letter to some of the trailblazers of pop and rock music history, many of them gone too soon.
Jimmy gave us rainbows. Janice took a piece of our heart and hold it.
But King takes the decidedly less subtle route of turning rock and roll heaven into a literal place, a pop music neverland inhabited by all the deceased A-listers of rock history. And we learn this when our two protagonists suddenly recognize the Rock-a-Boogie waitress to be none other than the smoky-voiced lead singer of Big Brother and the Holding Company, Janis Joplin.
Sing it!
Yeah!
And in true Stephen King fashion, Janice screams and a flood of maggots streams from her mouth. Janis Joplin, who died of a drug overdose in 1970, is popularly known for being a member of the so-called 27 Club, a collection of musicians and celebrities who died at 27 years old, which also includes the incomparable Jimi Hendrix, Brian Jones of the Rolling Stones, Jim Morrison of The Doors, and Amy Winehouse. But the 27 Club is just a cross-section of a far broader category, namely the unsettlingly high number of young celebrities and musicians in particular whose stars burned especially bright before suddenly being snuffed out by drug overdoses, heart attacks, and plane crashes. Seriously, folks, a lot of plane crashes. The Big Bopper, Buddy Clark, Patsy Cline, Cowboy Copas, Jim Croce, John Denver, Steve Gaines, Hawkshaw Hawkins, Buddy Holly, Ricky Nelson, Otis Redding, Jim Reeves, Richie Valens, Ronnie Van Zant, and Stevie Ray Vaughan. Well, technically, that was a helicopter.
Death of the
chopper!
It's this larger group of deceased musicians that seem to have captured King's imagination. The notion of so much talent and so many untimely deaths bringing just the right mix of allure and uncanniness for this little horror jaunt. Even Elvis Presley, dead at 42 years old in 1977, must have seemed quite young to King, who was in his early 40s himself when this story was first published. Born in 1947, Stephen came into this world during a massive sea change in pop music history. He would have been about 7 years old when the era of Bing Crosby and Sinatra-style pop was loudly interrupted by Chuck Berry, Little Richard, and Elvis Presley in the mid-1950s. At 16, he almost certainly saw the Beatles wow the entire nation on the Ed Sullivan Show. And in the months and years following, the emergence of the Rolling Stones, Bob Dylan, and Motown stars like Diana Ross and Marvin Gaye. And when he was 21, vast numbers of music lovers, many of them his own age, descended upon Woodstock, New York, for what was probably the most famous rock festival in history. And one of the bands that played at Woodstock was none other than Big Brother and the Holding Company, whose lead singer died so tragically young. And I'd argue that You Know They Got a Hell of a Band is more than just a delivery system for a slew of King's rock and roll references, because at this point in King's life, in the early 90s, there was something he shared with all the residents of rock and roll heaven. Fame. King was at this time already a household name, a name synonymous with pop culture horror, and it had been just a few years earlier that he had reflected on the dark side of celebrity and fandom with 1987's Misery. And for King, there must have been more to the dark side of fame than just the potential for crazed fans to come torture him. The late 80s was also the period of some of Stephen's worst substance abuse. Alcohol and pills and coke and, well, does any of this sound familiar?
You don't want no part of this sh**.
Heroin killed Janis, alcohol and pills claimed Jimi Hendrix and Hank Williams. Even some of the stars who ultimately made it out of the woods danced on a razor's edge between life and death. Think Johnny Cash, Eric Clapton, or David Bowie. And yes, Stephen made it out of the woods too, primarily thanks to his wife Tabitha, a story we explored in our Valentine's Day special about Stephen and Tabby, which you can find right up here. But the experience had to have been pretty fresh in his mind when he wrote this little story. Stephen King says that storytelling is an opportunity for him to, quote, write out his demons. Which means that rock and roll heaven is more than just a fictional town full of stunningly talented specters. It's a fate from which Stephen himself narrowly escaped. With the hook of You Know They Got a Hell of a Band now in place, King turns the dial of musician cameos up to 11.
The numbers all go to 11.
The story becomes a veritable who's who of dead rock stars. The diner's cook turns out to be Ricky Nelson, the singer of 1958's Poor Little Fool, who was killed in a plane crash just a few years earlier. As Mary tries to escape, she finds her exit blocked by the recently deceased Roy Orbison, singer of Pretty Woman, dead at 52. And next to Orbison is the bespectacled Buddy Holly, who was just 22 years old when he died in a plane crash alongside fellow musicians The Big Bopper, aged 28, and Richie Valens, singer of La Bamba, who is just 17. The tragic deaths of these three musicians were later immortalized in rock history by singer-songwriter Don McLean, who called it
the day the music died.
After dodging Roy Orbison and Buddy Holly and bolting out of the diner, Mary dives into the car next to Clark, and they roar past two onlookers who also happen to be legends of Southern rock, vocalist Ronnie Van Zant of Lynyrd Skynyrd, dead at 29, and guitarist Dwayne Allman of the Allman Brothers, killed in a motorcycle accident when he was just 24. Before the story is out, Mary and Clark have encountered police officer Otis Redding, singer of Sittin' on the Dock of the Bay. They've spotted 27 club member Jim Morrison of The Doors skulking outside a billiards lounge. And they've heard concert announcements made by Alan Freed, the 1950s DJ whose promotion of rock and roll brought it to national audiences for the first time.
And now everybody, let's really rock with Big Al Sears and our big band, and right now, right now!
And what a concert Freed announces. He rattles off a laundry list of deceased pop and rock performers, including Freddie Mercury, Jim Croce, Brian Jones of the Rolling Stones, Keith Moon of The Who, Motown singers Florence Ballard and Mary Wells, blues guitarist Stevie Ray Vaughan, and one of my personal favorites, Mama Cass Elliott.
Mama Cass, deceased, ham sandwich.
And of course, this musicological creep fest wouldn't be complete without an appearance by the king of rock and roll himself, who is appropriately the mayor of the town, Elvis Presley, found dead in his bathroom at the age of 42. Tragic victim of superstardom and drugs and fried peanut butter and banana sandwiches with bacon. I'm not kidding, look it up. You know, They Got a Hell of a Band isn't one of King's high-stakes stories with deeply compelling characters or viscerally terrifying moments, but the fact that King is mostly just having fun here doesn't mean he can't also offer some serious reflection on what we often forget when we throw on our favorite record or playlist, that youth and fame can be dangerous bedfellows, that prodigy comes at a price, and that the list of unlucky ones who have danced with death and lost is a long one, from Mozart and Schubert to Holly and Hendrix. At its heart, though, You Know They Got a Hell of a Band is also an homage, granted one that's dressed up as horror, to these great men and women of rock history, to the music they made, and to the long-lasting power that this music has in the lives of people like Marion Clark, or me, or you, or the King of Horror himself. And even if the likes of Elvis or Lynyrd Skynyrd don't tickle your own particular fancy, we can all relate to having a profoundly personal relationship with the music from our youth, whether that be the Fab Four, or T-Swift, or Radiohead, or the Eagles.
Man, come on, I had a rough night and I hate the f***ing Eagles.
Okay, well, I guess we gotta draw the line somewhere. If you like what we're doing over here at the Stephen Kingdom and would like to show us a little monetary love, our Patreon has all sorts of exclusive goodies for our supporters, including extended and deleted scenes, behind-the-scenes featurettes, early access to episodes, and your name in the end credits. Be sure to subscribe to the Stephen Kingdom channel here, and check out our past episodes here. Long days and pleasant nights, Constant Watchers.
You don't want no part of this shit.